Hello, I'm Denver 7's Micah Smith, and welcome to Denver Decides. Denver Decides is a community partnership dedicated to accessible and transparent elections. That partnership includes the League of Women Voters of Denver and Interneighborhood Cooperation and is presented by Denver 8 TV. Today, we're presenting a candidate forum in anticipation of the municipal election coming up on Tuesday, April 4th. Among other offices, this election includes the candidates vying to represent the city as Denver Auditor. Denver has an independently elected auditor to serve as a check and balance on Denver's strong mayor form of government. The auditor's office is responsible for internal audit services, prevailing wage, and minimum wage enforcement. Our format is a pretty standard one. The candidates will have timed opening and closing statements and rounds of questions that have been submitted by the organizers of the forum. All of their responses will be timed. Our timer monitor is out front where the candidates can see it. So, let's begin by meeting the candidates vying to represent the city of Denver as your auditor. The candidates are standing left to right facing the cameras in the order that their names will appear on the April ballot. So, beginning at my right is Timothy O'Brien, and here at my left is Eric Clark. Welcome to both of you. Let's go ahead and give them a round of applause for being here today. We will begin with 1 minute opening statements from each of the candidates, and we will proceed in ballot order with these statements. So, once again, starting at my right, here is an opening statement from Timothy O'Brien.
Well, thank you. I'm Timothy O'Brien. I'm the Denver Auditor, and I would be honored to have your vote in this upcoming election. I have the qualifications necessary to conduct the audits that are mandated by Denver City Charter. I bring over 40 years of experience in accounting and auditing to this office. I am independent of the work my office performs. I'm qualified as a CPA, licensed in Colorado for over 40 years. My experience includes conducting over 1,100 audits in accordance with those same professional standards that are in the Denver Charter. My name is at the top of the page. My signature is at the bottom of the page on every one of those audits. I am independent. I will always maintain the independence required by professional audit standards. I will never approach an audit with any preconceived notion of what the outcome of that audit should be. I'm qualified, I'm experienced, and I'm independent, and I'd be honored to have your vote.
All right. Thank you, Timothy. And now the opening statement from Eric Clark.
Sure. First of all, I'd like to thank Channel 8, our moderator, and the crew who made this possible today. Look, 2023 is a change year. This is an opportunity year on April 4th, 2023 to choose the direction we will take as a city. We can either choose to be mired in division and finger pointing, or we can do things differently. We can do better. We can focus on actual results. I'm a professional auditor. I work for the largest accounting firm in the world as a manager, doing work across the country and globally, including in the rural Middle East. I've taken on IT, capital construction, performance, and financial audit peer reviews in the hundreds to hold organizations accountable, to hold individuals accountable, and to get results for the folks who matter on the issues they care about, whether it be homelessness, construction, housing, public safety, and more. We deserve results in our city, and that's what I'm going to bring to the table in this election and in this office.
All right, thank you, Eric. Next, we will have rounds of questions submitted by the forum organizers, and each candidate will have 1 minute to answer. Candidates, we urge you to listen to your opponent's answer since there will be an opportunity for rebuttal or comment coming up. We will start in reverse order from the opening statements and begin the questions with Eric Clark. Eric, do you think the auditor should have subpoena powers, and why?
Yes. Yes, period. The city auditor did have subpoena powers, only very briefly. Unfortunately, there was a lawsuit filed suing city council over a data loss prevention amendment. City council actually had the foresight to protect not just critical data within the city systems, but the personal data held within auditees or organizations that fall under the ability of the auditor's office, as well as organizations investigated by Denver Labor. As a professional auditor, I have audited a police department where we had on-site review of very sensitive information within police filings. It is commonplace to carry out on-site review, and frankly, the loss of subpoena power a rule that would have protected Denver's workers from things such as minimum wage violations, as well as wage theft issues, was a failure of leadership. We can do better, and I will fight to restore subpoena power with the Data Loss Prevention Amendment.
Thank you, Eric. And now, Timothy O'Brien, do you think the auditor should have subpoena powers, and why?
Well, of course I think the auditor should have subpoena powers. I'm the one who asked the council to give the auditor subpoena power. And at the very last minute, the council passed an amendment on third reading late at night that really undermined the authority of the auditor to conduct audits. I will always defend the auditor's ability to conduct an audit under generally accepted government audit standards. Removing subpoena power was actually the right thing to do for me because we no longer had that conflict, which undermined the auditor's authority. Will we get subpoena power in the future? I don't know that it's terribly necessary. I mean, the auditor's gone without it for a long, long time. When it comes to Denver labor, there are a system of fines that we can impose on organizations that aren't cooperating, that aren't paying their employees as they should. I think that is enough of a tool to get compliance with those labor laws.
Now it's time for our next question. As auditor, how would you decide on which programs or agencies to audit? And Timothy, we start with you.
Whoa, just a minute for that. You know, we have a well-defined process as to how we go about allocating the resources in the auditor's process. We have what we go through what we call a risk assessment process, where we are collecting information all year long, keep it in a separate file in a secure place. We talk to the mayor, we talk to the council, we talk to people in the neighborhoods, we talk to the department heads. I've been to over 300 neighborhood organizations as auditor, and we get a lot of good information from people in the neighborhoods who are concerned about the programs and are concerned about how their tax dollars are being spent. We take all that information, we kind of pull it all together, because the auditor is required to produce an audit plan for the upcoming calendar year by the third Monday in October. So it's a very well-defined process. I think it gets us to the right place. And I'm pretty proud of the way we go about that.
And Eric, as auditor, how would you decide on which programs or agencies to audit?
Yeah, so we actually largely agree on how the annual audit plan should be derived. This should be a collaborative approach that is risk-based, understanding over the course of, and I would say even more than a year, over the course of the city's history, as well as best practices in the field. We look at construction as a major risk, and especially when we're talking about construction oversight, over $1 billion over budget at the Denver Airport Great Hall project. IT as a major challenge. Any organization not focused on actually auditing software is an organization that's not managing a really well-defined risk program. So that collaboration piece, integrating with the RNOs, with nonprofits, small businesses, stakeholders, and city council, understanding really deep and within the city what matters and where the audit not only can point out faults, but have the biggest impact at solving problems.
Well, here's the next question for our candidates, and we'll start with you, Eric. What would you do if agencies disagree with your findings and recommendations?
Yeah, there's always going to be some disagreement. In an ideal world, there will be collaboration prior to an audit report being released, so we understand if something was missed. I think a key example here is the Office of the Mayor's Office of Equity recently had an audit within this past year, where there are actual there was actually information omitted from the audit, and quite a bit of disagreement in the public space between the auditor's office and the mayor. Whenever there's information omitted, I think it's a big challenge to maintain credibility within an office. At the end of the day, the auditor's office should add value. And I think that's a really key turn of phrase, add value. If organizations, if departments, if functions do not agree or do not find an audit useful and they choose not to implement really important recommendations, then the city taxpayers suffer the most. And I think we need to maintain that mindset.
And Tim, what would you do if agencies disagree with your findings and recommendations?
Well, we have agencies that disagree with findings and recommendations regularly. I mean, wouldn't say all the time, or not even most of the time. But when that disagreement starts to raise its head and the communication we have with the agencies, it's really more about communicating with them about what the findings are saying and what the recommendation really means. And often there is a misunderstanding about what the recommendation says or what the findings leading up to it says. So do we get it 100%? No, not quite, but I'll bet it's mid-90%. And then, you know, we do follow up on every recommendation that an agency agrees to and follow up to see that they actually have done what they said they were going to do, or they may have done something, an alternative method to get to the same place. And I think that's great, and we report on those as we do the initial audit report.
Well, let's continue with more questions from our forum organizers. And Tim, you'll be first to answer this one. As auditor, would you agree to having a staff person in the room observing and taking notes during an audit?
Could you clarify that?
Would you want me to reread the question?
Please,
that I can ask?
Yes.
Yes. As auditor, would you agree with having a staff person in the room observing and taking notes during an audit?
We do that all the time. So yes, I would agree with that. That's a common practice in the way we conduct an audit. We call them grounding interviews, where we're trying to get a sense of what people do in a given organization, what their function is, how it works with other functions in the organization. But we usually have two auditors, one asking questions, one taking notes, because, you know, two people will hear better than one person will.
Right. Thank you. Now, Eric, your turn to answer the same question. As auditor, would you agree to having a staff person in the room observing and taking notes during an audit?
Yeah, multiple. Of course, I think we want multiple people in the room, especially multiple auditors who are able to understand if something is missed, taking good notes and understanding that sometimes we're talking about very complex issues. I'll just briefly talk about, I've taken two technology companies public through their SOX readiness programs, designing systems and controls, as well as looking in a really detailed level at software in terms of coding. We would have easily, you know, four or five auditors in the room during a very complex walkthrough, able to take screenshots on a screen, as well as taking very detailed notes and putting together follow-up questions. So it's pretty commonplace to have multiple auditors in the room at one time.
Well, what I would add, it is not commonplace for the agency to have multiple people if we want to interview one person.
Okay, thank you.
I don't know if that was really the intent of your question or not, but
well, we'll have time to
auditors.
Elaborate.
Okay.
I think we were just talking about someone from the same organization observing.
I'm not sure when you say same organization.
Okay.
The auditee or the auditor?
Our producers are listening now, so we'll have a point of clarification in just a second. It's the auditee.
Yeah, well, there are many circumstances where the auditee cannot have another person in the room.
Okay.
Taking notes. Because what that does is that really throws cold water on the conversation. What if that's your supervisor and you have something to say about what's going on in the organization that shouldn't be going on? So that's why we have two people and we only want one person from the other organization.
All right. And in the spirit of fairness, Eric, would you like to add another comment?
Sure. I think we're in agreement there. It's just, you know, according to the standards, you typically want depending on what you're looking at, either one person who multiple auditors are interviewing, or you would have more of a forum roundtable where you're just doing that fact-finding piece, which is much more appropriate to have multiple auditees in the room at one time.
All right. Well, let's move on to our next question for our candidates, and we'll begin with you, Eric.
Sure.
What would be your highest priority as Denver auditor?
Yeah, I think that, like I said before, construction is a huge risk within the city of Denver right now. It's a huge challenge. We tend to be building a lot, even in the public sector. Looking at the Denver Airport Great Hall project, we are over a billion dollars over budget, with nearly a decade of delays on that project now. It is a big problem. We look at the same, and frankly, it took 4 years to audit that project from that groundbreaking ceremony. Even more if you count from the contracting stage with not just one vendor, but a vendor, a failed vendor, now a new vendor within that 4-year mark. We saw a similar delay within the Peña Boulevard redevelopment project, as well as several of the general obligation bond projects. It is a best practice to start those engagements at the very beginning stage, at the contracting stage, to uncover some of those early warning signs and to prevent some of the snowballing and change orders that end up increasing costs.
Right. And Tim, what would be your highest priority as Denver Auditor?
Yeah, right now the highest priority, the City Council has given the auditor authority to conduct wage theft investigations. Getting that up and running is not going to be easy. It's going to be a big lift. We've gone from prevailing wage covering, 70, 80,000 employees who work in Denver. Add minimum wage, you bring in another 100,000 people working in Denver. When you include every person that works in the city and county in Denver could be subject to wage theft, we're somewhere north of 500,000 people who we potentially could get a complaint from. We've got rulemaking to get through. We've got, to get back to people on what their comments are in rulemaking. So that's a big one. The other one I would mention is we're going to have a new mayor. And I want to have, really a packet of information, a booklet, a briefing booklet on every department, on every audit that we've done, where we see the issues are, and have they been resolved or have they not been resolved.
And that brings us to the last of the prepared questions from our organizers. And Tim, you'll be first to answer this one. What do you see as the biggest financial hurdle facing Denver in the next 4 years, and how should the city be prepared to address that?
Well, there's probably more than one, but, I think a big financial hurdle right now is that some of these American Rescue Plan-like dollars will go away in the future. And if we've staffed up to a level and we don't have other revenue that come in and take the place of that revenue, we're going to have to lay people off. So Denver has to build, its revenue base back to where it was pre-pandemic. I would say other financial hurdles, the state of Colorado has passed an initiative 123, which will provide hundreds of millions of dollars to local government for housing. And Denver really needs to have the organizational infrastructure in place to accept those dollars, to deploy those dollars, and to be accountable for those dollars.
And Eric, what do you see as the biggest financial hurdle facing Denver in the next 4 years, and how should the city prepare to address that?
I was also going to bring up housing. Housing challenges, especially when we have a large influx of hundreds of millions of dollars around this within the scope of housing. It's not just the oversight and ensuring that there's legal compliance and good financial practices, but also performance. Are these dollars spent effectively or not? How much bang for your buck as taxpayers are you getting? So that housing piece is going to be huge, especially as folks struggle with affording their basic living expenses in our city. We need an auditor's office that is focused on results in terms of performance, as well as financial oversight and legal compliance oversight. When you have all those pieces of the puzzle together, you build a better, more responsive, more thoughtful, smarter, and more effective government. And I think we can get there as a city of Denver. When we talk about a lot of the federal dollars coming in, a lot of those are related to construction. Similar to my previous answer, we need to focus on those on good, sound construction oversight, following the rules as they're applied.
And now for this round, the candidates can choose to ask their opponent a direct question, or you can use your time for rebuttal to something your opponent has said earlier. So Eric, you're first up. Sure. You can ask Tim a question or make a rebuttal. And if it's a question, Tim, you would have 1 minute to answer. Eric, your question or comment.
Sure. I'll ask a question. So Auditor Dennis Gallagher, a friend of mine, said, quote, "I just think having a CPA does not guarantee that someone who's elected to the Denver Auditor's Office has the political wisdom to be able to ferret out where auditing should take place." What has been your biggest miss as auditor?
I don't know that I've had a big miss as auditor. I mean, I think we have tackled, the kind of problems that are facing the citizens and the city and county of Denver. We spend more time auditing out at the airport than any other department. You know, in terms of a miss, I really am hard-pressed to find one.
Okay. And now, Tim, you have a chance to either ask Eric a direct question or use the time for a rebuttal to something said earlier.
I'm ready.
Okay, go for it.
So, Eric, on your LinkedIn page, it looks like you have about 4 years of audit experience with some firms that provide audit services. On your campaign website, you talk about having audited hundreds, even as much as 650 audits in a 4 year period. That's going to be about 3 or 4 a week. That to me is impossible, but maybe you could tell us how you do that and still do those in accordance with professional audit standards.
Yeah, happy to answer that. So, of course, managed several dozen audits myself personally, like I said, in both the public and private sector. But through the use of AI technology as well as automated systems, we could knock out 3, 4, even 5 financial audit peer reviews in a single day. So I've quite literally worked on over 600 financial audit peer reviews. Actually, a large state government was my client at the time. And they had a requirement built in that any grantee of the state government was required to have a financial audit peer review. So of course, we've knocked out over 600 of those. And in terms of managing audits directly, I have worked with the US State Department. I have worked with overseas in rural Afghanistan. I have worked with city and state governments across the country on a variety of topics doing audit work.
I didn't hear how you comply with professional audit standards, and I want to tell you, peer reviews are not audits.
Sure, financial audits.
Well, we will have more time, if I may interrupt. We'll have more time for questions and rebuttals. So, Eric, you're actually first up, and you can ask Tim a question or make a rebuttal. And again, Tim, if it is a question, you'll have a minute to answer.
Sure. So, and I've brought this up several times because it's a big issue. The Denver Airport Great Hall project went $1 billion over budget, with a decade of delays. The best practice for construction oversight is to start audits at the contracting stage. Seems like a big miss to me. Why did it take 4 years to audit such a large critical project?
Well, I don't know where you're getting the $1 billion budget overrun. But we have an audit of the Great Hall reconstruction. I think it's coming out in April. Maybe a little bit late for campaign purposes, but we want the audit to be done right.
When was the project kicked off?
Early in 2022.
The Great Hall project was kicked off in 2022?
No, the audit was kicked off.
When was the Great Hall project kicked off?
Well, the Great Hall project has been kicked off a number of times. I mean, it was kicked off in 2015, where the City Council was given 30 days to review a 2,000-page document, and they went ahead and approved it anyway. That particular version of the Great Hall is the one that cratered, the one that was Ferrovial was, terminated from the project. So,
all right, it's time to move on. And now, Tim, it's your chance to either ask Eric a direct question or time for a rebuttal.
Sure. Eric, auditors check and they double check and they review and they confirm information. During your campaign, you have provided a lot of misinformation about whether or not I was running. You have been telling people I was not running for this position. You have been telling people that my office uses flash drives to transport sensitive information. You never confirmed that with me. You never confirmed that with my office. Will you use these reckless approaches to auditing if you are elected auditor?
Let's clarify two things. So, Mr. O'Brien, your deputy jumped into the race with your endorsement.
My deputy did not jump into the race. My deputy is named Valerie Walling.
Excuse me. Your executive director of Denver Labor jumped into the race with your endorsement. So, what does it appear as you're running if you've endorsed another candidate? So that's just first of all. Secondly, and I'm sorry, what was your second accusation?
The flash drives?
Sure. That wasn't me. That was Councilman Kevin Flynn.
But you repeated it and repeated it.
Yeah. After.
Did you ever think of checking or confirming, double checking? That's what auditors do.
Sure. And your office released a statement. Whether that statement was true or not remains to be told. The fact of the matter is department leadership, as well as external organization auditees, have attested that your office inappropriately used flash drives to transport critical and sensitive information. Are all these other individuals, is council lying, and these executive directors of organizations lying, or is it your office?
But you're the one spreading the information, and you're the one that has a responsibility to know what it you're talking about. And
all
is
right,
it
gentlemen,
everybody
else we are out
you?
Of time.
I
it is time
you.
For closing statements. All right. And again, that brings us to the end of the Q&A segment. For closing statements, each candidate will have 1 minute, and we will reverse the order of opening statements, which means we will begin with Eric Clark. Eric, you have 1 minute for your closing statement.
This is a change year. We as Denver residents deserve accountability in our city government, and we deserve results from our city government. We are not faced by a shortage of challenges, whether it's homelessness, housing, public safety, or any of the other varied significant challenges we face as a community. We need sound judgment as well as experience in this office. A judgment that will take on construction auditing in a sound, thoughtful way that is effective. Judgment that will not risk these personal and sensitive information of our taxpayers and the city, according to many folks. We have an opportunity in this election to do things better. Not pointing fingers of blame and division, but actually focusing on outcomes and problem solving. I'm running for city auditor as a professional auditor who's worked in both the public and private sector on a very significant number of audits that I'm very proud of, with results. And that's what we deserve as our next city auditor. My name is Eric Clark. I hope you'll vote on April 4th.
And now a closing statement from Timothy O'Brien.
Thank you. under my leadership, the Denver Auditor's Office has produced probably 400 audits that I think are impactful and have resulted in substantive change in city government operations, and that means they saved money. My auditor's office has received 5 awards for excellence in auditing from the Association of Local Government Auditors, and we're up for a 6th, and I like my chances of getting it there. 6 years ago, we established a data analytics team that uses leading-edge technology to assist our audits. This team regularly shares our data analytic techniques with other organizations around the country. Under my leadership, Denver Labor has become the largest municipal wage enforcement agency in the country. Other cities look to Denver Labor for guidance on how to structure their wage enforcement. Most important, we have returned millions of dollars to hardworking citizens who earn those dollars. Denver Labor is the subject of a Harvard research on wage enforcement best practices. My communications team and I have attended over 300 neighborhood organization meetings to hear how their input and how their tax dollars are being spent.
And Tim, we're at time here.
I'm qualified, I'm experienced, I'm independent, and I'd be honored to have your vote.
Thank you. Well, now it's the audience's turn. Let's show our appreciation to the candidates for their participation. Absolutely. Thank you to both of our candidates for being here. Our thanks also to the Denver Decides partners, which include Inter-Neighborhood Cooperation and the League of Women Voters of Denver. Denver Decides is presented by Denver 8 TV. We hope we've given you a fair look at each candidate vying to represent you as Denver auditor. Remember, Denver's municipal election takes place on an earlier date than ever before. Tuesday, April 4th is Election Day. Be sure you are registered, and be sure to make your voice heard. Vote. For complete election information online, go to denverdecides.com or denver7.com/denverdecides. Stay with us for more Denver Decides candidate forums coming up shortly. I'm Micah Smith from Denver 7. Thanks for joining us.